From exercises in the morning to a KGB spy series at night, it's television Soviet style. And we'll be tuning in tonight. Good evening. I'm Ted Koppel, and this is Nightline. Broadcasting to 275 million people over 11 time zones, Soviet television is sometimes predictably heavy-handed. Sometimes charmingly unpredictable. We'll look at what they show their children, their game shows, the news, and at a time when attention is focused on the American program about a fictional Soviet takeover, we'll look at what the Soviets broadcast about us.
This is a special edition of ABC News Nightline. Reporting from Washington, Ted Koppel.
They are menacing, fat, wear ill-fitting clothes, and have no sense of humor. We are drug-dealing racists whose social agenda is set by the Pentagon. We don't like each other, we don't trust each other, and if truth be told, we don't know each other very well either. The Soviets can, and indeed did, on their evening newscast today, point to the ABC miniseries America as an example of the sort of damaging anti-Soviet cliché that appears on U.S. television. What they actually showed was a small demonstration against the TV show in New York yesterday. But the Soviets have also been at great pains to point out that historically, the only invading that's taken place between the United States and the Soviet Union was back in 1918, when some American and British troops opposed to the Bolsheviks landed near Vladivostok.
The Americans and British wanted to grab the North, but we never gave up. In the end, they had to leave.
So much for dispensing with anti-Soviet clichés. What appears on their own television screens includes enough anti-American baloney to cover a mile of school lunches. Here are just a few slices.
This made-for-television movie is set in an America familiar to Soviet audiences.
But Flagam USA!
An America obsessed with entertainment and violence. And dominated by the military-industrial complex. The movie is a remake of the old Burt Lancaster film, 7 Days in May, about a military conspiracy to overthrow a peace-loving U.S. president.
What I have just learned is astounding. A surprise from the Soviets.
Here, the CIA chief, a U.S. warmonger, lies to the president about Soviet military maneuvers.
They are clearly preparing to assemble new missiles.
But unlike the American movie, this version ends before the peace-loving president can triumph over the CIA conspirators. At the end of the Soviet version, a reporter suddenly appears on screen. He is, in fact, a real Soviet reporter, the Washington correspondent for Soviet TV. There, to tell the audience that the movie is true to life.
This is how disinformation about the Soviet Union works, and the military-industrial complex reaches its aim.
The CIA also features in one of the most successful series on Soviet TV. A sputtering American spy trying to wrap himself in diplomatic immunity. This spy series, TASS informs, was so popular last year that Soviet engineers insist they could detect a dramatic increase in the consumption of electricity from all the sets in use. John Gleb is the anti-hero of TASS Informs. Gleb, who is CIA station chief in an unnamed African country, seems to serve only one discernible, useful function: being repeatedly outwitted by his KGB counterpart.
The subject of your research, the CIA and the international drug trade.
Crash?
Yes.
But remember Rambo and James Bond, and the simple reality that trash, like beauty, is in the eye of the beholder. Rich Poor is a television movie about a family fighting to earn a living in the American Midwest. The parents run a bakery shop on the verge of bankruptcy.
That's enough. You're not going to get anything before you pay your debt. I'm fed up.
One son is a hoodlum who buys his way out of jail. The daughter is seduced by the richest man in town. Note the American flag on his windshield, who takes her out for dinner and some light conversation.
Our family is rich. Very, very rich.
But your family has done a lot for this town.
I have sucked the blood out of the town.
The rich bloodsucker. Get it? Meanwhile, back at the bakery, they are being evicted.
You can't be a decent person in America when your pockets are empty.
Not at least in the America portrayed on Soviet television. If you are poor in a Soviet film about America, you might as well bake a batch of poison bread, leave it behind for your loved ones, and row out onto a foggy lake. If you find this ending obscure and melancholy, remember, this is a Russian film. And wait, it isn't over yet.
America, America, God shed His grace on thee.
Yes, that is Elvis Presley, and no, those ugly scenes of America have nothing to do with the movie. But they do make for a dramatic ending. Whoever was in charge of subtlety on Rich Poor must have taken that week off.
Oh, beautiful. Four spacious skies.
When we come back, a look at what's new on Soviet television, including some scenes that, thanks to the new openness, look as though they could be happening here.
This is ABC News Nightline.
Possibly we can strengthen the trust among ourselves. But how can we do that with the Americans who constantly cheat us? They say this, they make promises, but nothing ever comes of them. They sent that Korean airplane and deny it. But the plane didn't come here by itself.
How did you learn about that incident? Through the radio, TV, newspapers. We have a free press.
Vova,
what do they teach you in school about America?
They teach us a lot. Like how many times their weapons can destroy the planet and us. And which proposals come from the USSR, like the zero option.
So, you've heard about the zero option. What do you think about it?
The USSR counts the number of bombs in England and France, as well as the Pershing 2s. But America doesn't agree with that.
Children, let's talk about the relations between the USSR and the U.S. Who can tell us something about the United States of America? Yes, Julia.
The U.S. is a leading country in the world. It has a well-developed industry. It consists of 50 states. The head of the government is the president.
How large is the population of the U.S. now? Go ahead, Lida.
The population of the...
300 пластинок. Последнее, что осталось, вот 300 пластинок. Так мы приехали в Сибирь, 300 пластинок.
Моя мама ничего не успела взять.
Нет, не сохранились вот эти пластинки. Но музыка с детства постоянно сопровождала...
Нарада. Что пропонирует?
Smoking is dangerous for your health.
Like us, the Soviets are using television to acknowledge and to try to deal with some of their social problems. Smoking and, yes, even a growing drug problem. These pictures of Soviet drug addicts shown on television there last fall were something of a breakthrough. It was, in a sense, the first public admission that the problem even exists. There is quite simply more openness in Soviet society these days, and therefore more openness on Soviet TV. For example, an intriguing new program.
It's called From the 12th Floor. The name comes from the studio where the program originates. And by Soviet standards, it's an ambitious production. A talk show taped before a live audience featuring its own rock band and remote cameras, or, as the Soviets say, space bridges.
We see you and hear you and want to take part in the discussion.
Today's remote location, that decadent Western invention, the discotheque.
Look how many people are here. It's a full house, like every night. What attracts you to this discotheque?
Here you can relax, and the people are nice.
How do you spend your leisure time? Whatever comes along, but generally here.
I try to spend my free time in as interesting a way as possible. Here at the movies, with friends.
Mainly we just dance.
But not everyone on the program approves.
We should develop a different tradition using these new technical facilities. Otherwise, it's just a bourgeois mass entertainment culture and not of the best kind.
You are wrong. It's just relaxation. People just come there to relax.
But it's not just the bourgeois leanings of Soviet youth which get an airing. In this edition, the topic is the country's housing shortage, a chronic problem.
What we are looking for is social justice.
Selected for today's audience, a group of young adults who want permission to build their own apartments. Also selected, local housing officials who are pushing a plan for temporary dormitories.
You are advocating that young people live in this youth housing project. Let me ask you, would you want to live in them, and where do you live now?
I live in my own apartment because I have a big enough salary to afford it.
Such lively debates on television are a key part of the Soviets' new campaign for openness. TV producer Eduard Sagalayev.
Sometimes the ministry is forced to take part in the discussion. And they don't yet understand that the time is right to start answering tough questions.
Judging from this newscast, apparently the time is right for... ...any kinds of tough questions. This is investigative reporting, Soviet style. First, a building contractor is interviewed about completing a new apartment complex.
I'm very satisfied.
Then, the camera goes inside.
Look, I just opened the door and it falls off. The closet, no single shelf. Where should I get them? There is water on the floor. We'll have to have new linoleum.
And now, back to the builder.
What do you say now, Anatoly Pavlovich?
I have nothing to say.
We don't know what happened to Anatoly Pavlovich, but we expect he hasn't heard the end of it. And even the traditional Soviet documentary is asking tough questions. This one concerns the unlikely subject of Soviet fashion. The point here, there isn't enough of it.
Because our industry isn't yet producing them. You know, it's very rare to find what you want in the shop. You have to walk around a lot. The best chance you have to buy something decent is to find something imported. The assortment of Soviet-made goods is usually very boring.
Who's to blame? The favorite target, the unwieldy Soviet bureaucracy, as this fashion designer explains.
I have great difficulties with the artistic council. There is also a long process to introduce the product. You have to prepare a technical documentation, and that has to be done in conformity with state standards, according to the quota. So by the time it is introduced into the market, no one wants or needs the product anymore.
Even these dresses, which have already become popular, that people line up to buy daily, have to be approved and reapproved by layers of bureaucracy. Don't you think the opinions of thousands of consumers who have voted with their rubles for their fashions are more important than the bureaucrats?
But there are limits to all this newfound criticism. No criticism is ever heard of Central Committee policies or of General Secretary Gorbachev. This is producer Sagalayev's explanation.
It must seem strange to you because Americans have a stereotype view of us. But the fact is that there are very few people who would reject the policies of our party. You should believe it. That is the case.
In fact, there are quite a few people rejecting the policies of the party these days, but we'll have more on that later in this program. When we return, we'll look at the most popular game show in the Soviet Union. Why the most popular? Well, maybe you can decide.
Jeff and Becky, you are now husband and wife. You may now kiss your bride.
Битлз. Но вас больше никакой музыки не тянет.
Вы знаете, я люблю хард-рок, еще люблю аквариум. Люблю, ну, в основном ленинградские группы, советские.
А с чего началась вот эта ваша любовь?
Ну, вы знаете, я услышал где-то в 9 лет Битлз. И мне очень понравилось. Я начал развиваться. Потом Rolling Stones, Deep Purple, Led Zeppelin. Вот, уже считающийся классикой.
Может, не зная языка, вы уже знали название группы.
Классическая музыка, она, в общем, очень глубокая. Ее трудно понять.
Можно.
Я, например, ее так не понимаю. Вот для меня это просто пиликанье на скрипках.
А вот на стенде стоят разные пластинки. Вот какие имена вам знакомы? Кого бы вы хотели, например, послушать? Или слышали когда-нибудь?
Ну, знакомых-то здесь много всего, но послушать, честно говоря, не очень.
Ну, назовите, кто вам знаком?
Давид Ойстрах знакомый. Борис Годунов, знакомая опера.
Так. Ну, Жизель, наверное.
Ну, Жизель, конечно, знакомая.
Рихтер, наверное.
Рихтер знакомый, что там еще?
Ну, Прокофьев, Бах.
Прокофьев, конечно, знакомый.
Ну, то есть вы практически знаете.
Я все это все
но
знаю.
Но почему же такое неприятие вот этой музыки? Ну, я просто
она
себя хочу
нравится.
Выяснить.
Ну, вот это трудно понять. Я включаю эстрадную музыку, она меня сразу по всем жилам проходит, а эта музыка не проходит.
Классическую музыку нужно слушаться, нужно понять, нужно как-то перестроиться. Ну, а в темпе жизни, да,
в темпе жизни, телефон в руке, да, и слушать, да, по дороге, да, какой-нибудь,
понимаете,
там...
вот это вот все. Ну и тем не менее, конечно, вот я считаю, что я просто без музыки классической жить не могу. И всю свою жизнь я этому посвятила. То есть я видела все, мне все это знакомо. Я слышала Лемешева, я слышала там, ну, буквально всех певцов. Мне опера больше, так сказать, вокал нравится.
If you have ever wondered whether Americans have anything else in common with the Russians, you are about to find out. The one phenomenon that apparently bridges our culture gap is the television game show. We have many, many more of them, and the silliest among ours need not take a backseat to any silly game show in the world. But the Russians are clearly contenders. Take a look at this. It's called Come On Girls. The contestants on Come On Girls are young, unmarried women. Marina, a stewardess from Moscow. Svetlana, a farm worker from Krasnodar. Mariam, a young Communist League leader. Oksana, a shop assistant from Minsk. And Svetlana, a construction engineer from Krasnoyarsk. Come on down. The popular host of the show is Sasha Maslikov.
Good day, guests. Good day, comrades television viewers. And good day, sweet contestants.
The sweet contestants are picked from local competitions. Come On Girls, which airs every few months, has been on the air now for 17 years. It's a 90-minute production beginning, for some unexplained reason, in an airplane. Then on to a troika ride through Moscow. Finally, down to the business at hand. A kind of game show decathlon. They lasso reindeer.
Нет. О! Так, молодец.
And they race reindeer.
Our
leader is changing, and now it's Svetlana.
And they clean house.
And now, girl, go.
After every contest, host Maslikov awards points.
Так, Марина Ужова первая закончила.
Марина was the first to finish her territory.
Я смотрю.
I am looking.
Я смотрю.
I am looking.
Лен, я верю тебе, но...
I believe and I agree.
Верю и соглашаюсь.
There is nothing wrong. Марина gets 5 points.
5 баллов.
А в наших передачах они же не только там, не знаю...
They are not only peeling potatoes and vacuuming. They show how good they are at their profession. Literature. There are masses of things that every human being ought to know. Whether a man or a woman. I don't think it's humiliating at all.
On the program we watched, there were no questions about literature. There were, however, questions about cooking.
This is another nice question. What happens to mashed potatoes when you add cold milk?
You don't add cold milk to potatoes because they turn gray.
Correct. Correct. 6 points.
And finally, a dance contest. But if you were expecting quaint Russian folk dances...
Mm-hmm.
different dances, same partner, the Come On Girls dance instructor. That's it. Thank you, Mr. Dance Instructor. Now, finally, the winner.
Марина Ужова, Москва.
And after lassoing reindeer, cleaning house, and dancing up a storm, Marina's prize? A China tea set. And what do the runners-up get? China tea sets. Show host Maslikov says that unlike American game shows, the... like Wheel of Fortune, but which serves a much more serious purpose. A Russian watching for the first time children's television in America. Those Saturday morning cartoons with which we seek to anesthetize our young. The gentle genius of Sesame Street. And, of course, the commercials which target our children. It is at least one perspective on how we view our children and ourselves. But while we are selling toys and cereals, the Russians are selling the roots of their ideology.
Всем.
As in this cartoon about the Russian Revolution in 1917.
Власть.
All power to the Soviets.
Земля.
Land to the peasants.
Мир.
Peace to people.
Хлеб.
Bread to the hungry.
Another cartoon transports a little boy back to the Civil War during the year 1919.
Но если ты хочешь помочь революции, возьми пакет и скачи в штаб дивизии.
Even for children, the possibility of the ultimate sacrifice. But it's not all ideology and propaganda. This is Good Night, Kids. It's only 15 minutes long, but it's on every night, nationwide, at 8.
Good evening, my little friend. Good evening, boys and girls.
Ola and Liena Mayorova watch every night, and so it seems does every other Soviet child under the age of 8. Goodnight Kids, with its puppets and cartoons, seems to have captured some of the aura of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. Its messages carry the sort of universal gentleness that most parents, Soviet or American, find comforting.
Прости нас, Леопольд.
Прости, а?
Ребята, давайте жить дружно.
And finally, there is this. A zany quiz show for young people. It's called What, Where, When. If, as has been suggested, a camel is a horse designed by a committee, What, Where, When is a quiz show designed by the Central Committee. Scheduled unpredictably once every few months, it is at times delightful, but chaotic. Round one. A team of youngsters spins the wheel, but this is no Wheel of Fortune. They're selecting questions sent in by the audience. The first one requires a hands-on approach. The contestants are asked to hold the snake, to pat it on the head, and to scratch it behind the ears. Ears? Did they say ears?
We decided that he has no external ear. So in principle, it is impossible to do such a thing.
Well, Mr. Unseen Host, how did the kids do?
You are quite right.
Round five. The score, 2 for the audience, 2 for the team. The questions get a little tougher. recite lines from Pushkin.
Значит, подруга не моих суровых, голубка дряхлая моя.
That was easy, but how about identifying the owner of this piano?
Давайте быстрее.
Sorry, the answer is Tchaikovsky, as the audience is only too eager to volunteer. Prizes? Yes, there are prizes, but we're not talking about vacations on the Black Sea here. Books, poetry, literature, and sometimes unexpected lessons in ethics. The team has just correctly answered the winning question, identifying the classic Soviet movie Potemkin. But members of the audience accused the team of cheating, of being prompted by their coach.
Настя, скажите честно.
Yes, yes, I was prompted. I didn't even think that it might be a film. We give up this point. There was a prompting.
The confession brings the audience to its feet.
Молодцы!
Good for you. Despite the loss, and you have lost the game 6-4, I believe that in our eyes you have won. And we will be waiting for you again at the game table. The game is over. Thank you very much.
Our next topic, when we return, Soviet television news. Who runs it? How it's run? And how it appears to be changing.
Programs that celebrate. Первая она называется «Преодоление». Расскажет об истории и сегодняшнем дне города Волхова Ленинградской области. Вторая познакомит с достопримечательностями крупнейшего железнодорожного узла Бама-Тынды. Новости в 10:25 и затем после перерыва в 16:00. 16:15 мы приглашаем ребят на спортивную программу, подготовленную телевидением ГДР. Делай с нами, делай как мы, делай лучше нас. Выпуск новостей в 17:15. В 17:20 мы предлагаем вашему вниманию передачу «Звездные войны. Обман и обольщение Америки». Разговор пойдет о том, кто стоит за программой «Звездных войн» и о том, как американские средства массовой информации пытаются создать привлекательный образ Сои. Ведет передачу корреспондент гостелерадио СССР в Нью-Йорке Вадим Лобаченко. В 17:50 выступает академический оркестр русских народных инструментов Центрального телевидения и Всесоюзного радио. Дирижер, народный артист РСФСР Николай Некрасов. Очередной выпуск тележурнала «Трезвость. Нормы жизни» продолжит тему борьбы с пьянством в семье и на производстве. На этот раз передача подготовлена Донецкой студией телевидения, а посмотреть вы ее сможете в 18:15. Комментарии международных событий 18:45. «Мир планете Земля» — так называется концерт, который...
...means time. Время is also the name of the television program, which the Soviets say is their most popular, the evening news. Today, the Soviets gave Время a little more time than usual. Mikhail Gorbachev addressed an international peace conference. That was the lead story. And the lead story ran a little long, 1 hour long to be precise. The rest of the news followed. An estimated 150 million viewers watch Vremya every evening. There is nothing else on. It is shown at 9 p.m. in 11 time zones on all channels. And in Moscow, it is also shown on this huge television screen not far from Red Square.
Добрый вечер.
Здравствуйте, товарищи.
And who decides what the Soviets see every night on the news? The State Committee for Television and Radio, which produces Vremya. And workers like Andrei Shturua, an associate editor who starts his day in the wire room, checking the TASS news agency for stories.
I think it would be rather interesting for me, personally, the meeting of public in Moscow for 42nd anniversary of socialistic revolution in Bulgaria.
and Shturua's boss, Vitali Biloborodko, who, like all the top editors at Vremya, is a member of the Communist Party, one of an elite 16 million in a country of 266 million people.
The party is the leading force of our society. See, so the party members on the first front of any activity in all collectives, and on TV including.
But recently, party members at Vremya have come under fire, not for violating the party line, but for being too boring. As part of the new openness campaign, Vremya is under orders to make the news more interesting, more critical. Fewer socialist anniversaries, more tough reports, like this one.
Here are the peasant living quarters. No central heating, no piped water.
This recent story is about a farm cooperative with a corrupt director.
Look at all the slogans on every street corner, all saying how hard everyone has worked to fulfill the plan and overfulfill the plan. In actual fact, under this director, the farm has lost 9 million rubles of production.
We put very much attention on the economy, especially right now, because there are very many labs in this field, and we are trying to help the country and the party to improve the situation in the economy.
As part of this effort, Vremya editors must lead every newscast with party or economic news. On this evening, the lead is a predictably optimistic report on the Soviet shipbuilding industry. But openness has recently led to some economic reporting you wouldn't expect to see in a Marxist state. Like this glowing profile of a capitalist success story. McDonald's.
It is so profitable that hundreds of other restaurants have opened, providing what Americans call fast food.
This feature, which aired last fall, seems to be preparing Soviet citizens for a deal, reportedly in the works, between their officials and an American fast food pizza chain. And there are other surprises in the news.
Embarking on a road that will lead us to devastation.
The day we visited Vremya, Soviet reporter Yuri Rostov interviewed foreigners in Moscow about the Soviets' nuclear moratorium.
So as to today, I've spoken to six different groups of people. They all, of course, knew of moratorium, all wanted to speak, and, well, they supported our policy. We think it's very good, a positive sign.
But Soviet correspondent Vladimir Posner, a familiar guest on American television, got another point of view. For the first time on the Soviet news, Posner interviewed an American correspondent, ABC's Sam Donaldson, about the White House position on the moratorium.
We have not completed our test to modernize our weapons, and if we were to stop testing now, we would be at a distinct disadvantage.
The Soviets may be showing two sides to that story, but there is only one side to their coverage of Afghanistan, where they still maintain 120,000 troops.
We will soon go home, but the war against the friendly people at our borders continues, thanks to bandits armed by imperialist reactionaries.
With satellite feeds and over 100 reporters stationed around the world, Vremya editors say they operate much like an American news network. Senior anchorman Alexander Kirillov even compares himself to Walter Cronkite.
The viewers are now very demanding of those who appear on television. They must be trusted. If they can be trusted, that means they can be convincing. And that's the most important thing.
To be convincing, yes, and more candid and open. But this is still the only news in town. There are no ratings. There is no competition.
Внимание, мы в эфире.
Добрый вечер.
Здравствуйте, товарищи.
And if, at the end of the day, they want to spend 4 minutes on the 42nd anniversary of the Socialist Revolution in Bulgaria, who's to complain? When we come back, we'll talk about television Soviet style with Nick Hayes, a U.S. professor of Soviet history who regularly monitors Soviet TV, and with Soviet commentator Vladimir Posner in Moscow. Earlier today, we talked in our Washington bureau with Nick Hayes, professor of Soviet history at Hamline University and McAllister College in St. Paul, Minnesota. He anchors a local public TV program that reports on Soviet television. And we spoke also with Soviet commentator Vladimir Posner in Moscow. Vladimir, let's start off on an easy general one. Your perception of the purpose of Soviet television versus the purpose of American television.
Basically, I think you're looking at a difference between money and, if you wish, ideology. Television in the United States depends on money, at least commercial television, and that's what real television is in the States, as far as I understand it. In the Soviet Union, television is dominated by a certain philosophy, a certain set of ideas.
All right, tell me, what are those philosophies? What are the ideals? And take beyond the kind of blunt propaganda that we all know about.
Well, First of all, I'm not going to react to the blunt propaganda that we all know about. I want to say that I think the philosophy is basically that television is an influence. It educates people, or it can poison people's minds, and therefore it has to be used in a way that is beneficial. And what you want to do is try to educate people in the broad sense of the word, both in the sense of art and culture and history and knowledge, and even an understanding of humankind.
All right, now, some of the shows that we have seen during the course of this past hour are, to put it rather candidly, more educational than others. For example, the Come On Girls is hardly an educational program, but I gather it's a very popular one.
Well, it depends how you look on it. It has a lot to do with pastimes and hobbies and developing your talents. If you use the word in a broad sense, you've got a combination there of entertainment, but also of, you know, developing yourself, whatever your personal desires might be. So I think it can, in the broad sense, be worked into education to a point.
All right. You are part of Soviet television.
Very much so.
When you, for example, and your managers sit down and you discuss what kinds of things you want to do on television, give us an insight into those discussions.
We judge a program on the response of listeners, mainly in this country, through letters that come in vast numbers, and we see how people feel about it. Also, we do some polling. And of course, there's an other aspect to it, and that is we may get phone calls from people in different, shall we say, important positions who like or dislike what was on television. And in all honesty, I have to say that we can't totally disregard these calls.
Well, I would hope. I mean, how high does it? I mean, would Mr. Gorbachev ever pick up the phone and call Vremya and say, "I saw the news today, and I really thought
it was boring"?
No,
I don't think so. Although I would not rule out the possibility of his calling if he found a program especially to his liking. He might call to congratulate someone, say, "You know, I think you did a wonderful job on that." But however, there can be calls from people in the Central Committee.
All right, Mr. Hayes, talk to me a little bit about your perception of how Soviet television has changed over the last, pick a period. What, since Gorbachev is in, that might be as good a period as any. Is it possible to perceive a change during that period?
Oh, very dramatically, Ted. I've been following Soviet television for roughly 10 years, and in the last 15 months to 2 years, there's been a dramatic change in terms of the quality, the content, the technique, and the substance of Soviet television. It's evident in the news, it's evident in the entertainment, it's evident in their coverage of us and many other things.
Now, one of the things I noticed, Vladimir, particularly in the segment that we showed from the 12th floor, is that there seems to be, as there certainly is in this country, a generational difference.
That's absolutely true. I think if you look at Soviet television, and not only Soviet television, you'll see that one of the concerns has to do with teenagers. There is a problem. I recall one very powerful show where a young, kind of a punk, said, look, we are your product. You've tried to ignore us. You've tried to say that we're not here, but we are, and we're not nice. We're dirty, we're not attractive, and we want you to know it. You created us.
Nick Hayes, clearly there are a number of problems that the Soviets do discuss. Are there any that you have perceived that they are still unwilling to grapple with on television?
Well, you see a fairly obvious pattern to an American observer. There has been, from a Soviet point of view, just really shocking exposés of bureaucratic corruption, scenes like the story of Anton Pavlovich and the housing manager, poor retail sales and whatever. What I suppose to the American mind one keeps waiting for is some larger questions ever to be asked, some larger challenges to, say, basic principles of economic policy and institutions. These we haven't seen yet.
Vladimir, over the past couple of days, the story from the Soviet Union that has dominated here in the United States have been of the demonstrations for the release of Mr. Begun. And the roughing up by some identifiable or unidentifiable thugs who may or may not have been representing the government. That has played here. Did it play on Vremya? Was there any mention of it on Vremya?
No. I have not seen anything on Vremya about this. Although I think that what is happening is very important, both the fact that there were the demonstrations and also the fact that they were broken up. I think it reflects some of the tensions, some of the opposition that exists in this country to the changes. When Mr. Gorbachev speaks of revolutionary changes, I totally agree with him, but I would only add that where you have revolution, you also have counter-revolution. And you have people who don't want the changes to occur.
Our assumption is, and it may be wrong, I have no way of knowing, but our assumption is that these were plainclothes cops who broke it up. You are suggesting to me that it is kind of a spontaneous counter-revolutionary attitude. Tell me what you are suggesting.
No, I am not suggesting that, and if that's what I made it sound like, I'm sorry I didn't make my thought clear enough. What I'm saying is that within the society itself, within the bureaucracy, at different levels, there are people who are against what is happening today in this country and who are trying to block it in whatever way they can, to compromise it whatever way they can, to see that it doesn't work.
You're actually saying that it may be one form of the official bureaucracy struggling with another form of the Soviet bureaucracy against this policy of glasnost, that this is...
Well, Mr. Gorbachev has said quite clearly that this kind of opposition is making itself felt. This is no secret. It's out in the open. This is just one example of it, one that has been pounced on as being very dramatic and quote-unquote newsworthy. But there are many others that are not as evident, perhaps, but even more effective in the sense of being more difficult to deal with.
The evening wouldn't be complete, I suppose, without some comments on America, with a K. Give me your reaction and put it in the context of good television, bad television, useful at least in terms of getting us to talk about some of the issues that are raised.
I tend to hope that this series is simply bad television. What I've seen, to me, looked quite boring. And I'm hoping that perhaps the American audience will see through it. And in that sense, it's bad television. It's bad television because the aim is bad, in my opinion. Again, it's influencing people. It's poisoning minds. It certainly is not helping them have a broad understanding of anything at all. In that sense, it's very bad television, too. That's how I would see it.
Gentlemen, I thank you both. I'll be back with a closing comment in just a moment.
When the tight eight.
In a very obvious sense, television tells a lot less about us than those of us in television sometimes like to pretend. We specialize in stereotypes and cliches, and because our programs are designed to appeal to such vast numbers of viewers, we tend also to reduce everything to a lowest common denominator. Even so, what is reflected on our television screens is at least a diluted image of what we think we are and what some of us aspire to be.
And even by that very limited standard, it is interesting and more than a little revealing to see how the Soviets view themselves. Sometimes it's a bit disconcerting to discover how much we have in common, even with our adversaries. That's our report for tonight. I'm Ted Koppel in Washington. For all of us here at ABC News, good night.
This has been a special edition of ABC News Nightline, brought to you by Shearson. If you wish a printed transcript of this or any Nightline broadcast, please send $3 to Nightline Transcripts, 2 John Street, New York, New York, 10038. Nightline is a presentation of ABC News.
Young people, as was just stated, are worthy heirs to our legacy and do not forget past achievements and add new achievements to the old, as was said at the January plenum. This is our agenda for the future and our hope. This month, I will celebrate my 70th birthday, so I am already a member of the older generation. Throughout those 70 years, I have been continually enriched by our party, and my life has been enhanced by our cause. Leninist convictions kept us going and supported our work. We hope that what we are doing will definitely lead to change, basic change for the better. You know, what always inspires me and what we wish for the younger generation and advise them to do is to imitate their elders, our veterans. They have strong minds. They are people with powerful minds. People with powerful minds can solve any problem and can survive anything. Secondly, there must be dedication to the revolution. So thank you.
Then, Mikhail Sergeyevich Gorbachev visited the Memorial Museum of the Latvian Red Riflemen.
Comrade Gorbachev signed the guest book.
Surrounded by hundreds of oak trees, a symbol of the courage and heroism of the people of Riga, the eternal flame burns. Behind it are row upon row of communal graves.
Rodin's
sculpture, the mother, rounds out the picture.
Mikhail Sergeyevich Gorbachev
visited the Memorial Communal Cemetery of Riga. He placed a wreath before the eternal flame.
In our country, so much work is underway, so many things are being undertaken. Basically, we have achieved a degree of well-being which allows, or rather, now our life is such that it is possible to no longer be limited to being simply a worker, a construction worker, a machine operator, or adjuster. It is interesting to work in any field now, and will become more interesting as the years go by, and will be even more so by the time